Hello boys and girls, it's me, Vince, also known as PleasantKenobi on the internet. I'm the magic content creating equivalent of rain on your wedding day. It's like rain. This week I'm faking some repack videos on the internet to get views. Nope, not really, only joking, it's time for some 1v1 commander, kids. But seriously though, don't buy or support repacks, it's a false economy and it's a scam and everyone that is involved in it is a dickhead. This week we are playing with my favourite MTG lady of all time, Thalia, Guardian of Thraben. This innocuous little 2-1 forces your opponent to try and play a little bit slower and fairer. It's like the maths teacher that used to tell you to slow down when you're doing your working out at school, apart from the fact that her breath doesn't smell of alcohol and her bitter disdain of children doesn't seem to stem from a marriage that is secretly falling apart behind the scenes. She also isn't clambering to stay relevant as she ages by wearing novelty ties and driving a sports car that was bought on high interest credit, and she didn't get fired for inappropriate comments directed at the sixth formers. Yeah. Thalia is the number one Guardian of Thraben. Tasked with heading up the Cathars who protect the humans of Innistrad, she's a badass warrior paladin looking to make people play fair. She enjoys both the works of Beethoven and Bach and really likes pistachio ice cream. Her favourite Star Wars movie is Empire for its bleak tone and downbeat ending, and she much prefers the Beatles to the Rolling Stones. She's also the linchpin around my favourite deck in pretty much every single format, Death and Taxes. Death and Taxes is essentially a White Weenie deck that plays disruptive little creatures and aggroes out your opponent while stopping them from executing their own game plans. This is pretty much an aggro commander list, playing cards like Signal Pest and Winter Orb to really go for it. Essentially, this is a collection of my favourite disruptive and aggressive white cards I've ever been printed, and it's aimed towards smashing my opponent's teeth in as quickly and as efficiently as possible whilst they don't get to play much magic. The deck list will be linked in the description below and allow you to peruse and even purchase the deck at your own leisure, or whatever cards you need from MTGO Traders. If you don't know already, they are now the official sponsor of the channel. It's where I have been getting all of my MTGO cards from for the past 2 years. If you use the discount code GGGETREKT to get 8% off any PayPal orders from them, it supports our channel and helps me to make more content. But before we jump into this game, remember kids, there are only three things certain in life: death, taxes, and that PleasantKenobi is going to be casting Thalia and shouting GG get wrecked. And it's time to pay your taxes, you scrubs! We have a hand with an army of cats in a can and a winter orb, so it's time to slap bitches with the Lion King. Hakuna Matata, motherfucker. Our opponent is on the infamously degenerate Narset, although I feel she will be a little bit too slow in the face of the more aggressive 1v1 commanders like ours. With no turn 1 play, we slam Windbreast Heights and put a Sword of Light and Shadow under it. The protection from white should be quite good here. He suspends Ancestral Visions. Fuck you, Ancestral Visions. We stick everybody's favourite Cathar and consider our options for Enlightened Tutor. Thalia meets a Chainlight into the face. We then get to stick the Lion King himself, Brimaz. I decided to go and get myself a Spirit of the Labyrinth for my upkeep and cast it on my turn after drawing it, gunning to disable that Ancestral. Fucking Ancestral. However, without the appropriate stops set up on my MTGO, I fuck it up and don't get to do this. That's a punt. We slam in and make another cat. Cats. Attacking with Brimaz is a great feeling, and our fencer gets slapped out of the stack by a traditional counterspell, and our opponent misses a land drop, and we successfully enlighten the upkeep to draw a Spirit of the Labyrinth. Fuck you, Blue. However, Blue says fuck you right back and swats it out of the stack with a disallow. Tasty. We make more cats. Cats. Our opponent unfortunately draws a shitload of cards through Ancestral Visions. Partly Jace joins the fray, but our opponent is a loner and only draws cards for himself. He plays another Pain Land. Between this, Brimaz, and the Hall of the Bandit Lord, our opponent is getting pretty close to dead before he even gets a chance to cast his Narset. We untap and we play Knight of the White Orchid, get a land, and go for the backbreaking Winter Orb here. But of course, tapped out, he has Force of Will like they always do. What a load of shit. He also bolts on Knight. He must have something against white knights. Perhaps he's one of these sorts that leave shitty comments about feminism on Anita Skeezin's videos on YouTube. Ha! We cat daddy the shit out of his face. Killing Jace is an option here, but I would rather just get our opponent dead. Attack land from him and we get to untap with our army of cats again. Cats! Unfortunately for us, he does have Cryptic Command here and taps the team, but hurts himself enough while doing it to go to one life and turn off both his hall and his city next turn. We deploy the original gangster Elspeth and make a dude. Playing Thalia here to turn off a 3-man of Wrath would have been a better line in my opinion, but that was with hindsight, so live and learn, I guess. He untaps, and he draws, and then he draws again off of Jace, and he concedes. GG, Narsi. We keep a very aggressive 7 with a 1 drop, a 2 drop, but no actual 3 drop. However, both of our 4 drops are fucking wicked, so I'm super confident we can get there with this hand. The thing is, when I look at the hand initially and choose to keep it, I miss the fact that one of the lands is tapped, so our curve is a mess unless we draw top deck runner runner lands. We are against the biggest meta percentage share in Brea. I don't know if they do anything other than perhaps play 4 colour good stuff, because I haven't really looked into the lists and don't know enough about the format, but I'm confident that Thraben's Finest can fuck them up anyway. We draw runner runner lands because it's better to be lucky than good, and we're leading Signal Pest into Thalia. Our opponent Vampiric Seals in end step for the full 2 mana after we've cast Thalia, which is the very opposite of value, which I call Nalu. Our opponent doesn't do a lot, we get into the red zone, then we resolve a Selfless Spirit. However, we are then blown out by Toxic fucking Deluge for 1. Selfless Spirit is unable to save Thalia from her fate. Like this video if you cry every time. We untap and slam a Hero Bladehold and feel nostalgia for Standard's past. Hero is an absolute badass of an army in a can. Our opponent resolves his own army in a can with Brea and Wastelands Aramiria, which is a little bit rude if I'm honest. I took a risky line of Palace jailing his Bruna here. If he let Bruna go to exile by toggling it to go to exile as opposed to the command zone and then hit me with a single token, next turn I would stop being a monarch and he gets her back with 2 more Thopters and a shitload of mana to really ruin my day. He does not see this line. Today is a good day. And to add to this great feeling, we are now the monarch.
Hail to the king, baby.
We decide to smash in with a Hero Bladehold, which triggers and makes 2 soldiers and then pumps their front end with Battlecry. If swinging with Brimaz is the White Weenie equivalent of eating a tea-soaked cookie every turn, Bladehold is cookies whilst receiving oral sex wearing a particularly comfortable hat. He blocks 1 soldier and takes 5 damage. Our monarch status draws us a crusade. Crusade plus hero makes my cock hum with the sound of tubular bells. Our opponent steals the crown from us like a filthy usurper and ramps with Mindstone plays in the Jani Vengeant, which he then uses to tap down and freeze everyone's beloved hero. We untap and activate Nykthos for 4 mana, a bonus of 1. We use this to cast Crusade, cast Skullclamp, and equip Skullclamp to Palace Jailer. This means our jailer can sort out angry our Jani man with exactly lethal to kill it, and our soldier can snatch back the crown. Our crown draws the Dust Bowl at the end of our turn, and our opponent taps out for Brea and makes a shedload of blockers. Feeling safe behind this wall of blockers, our opponent snatches the crown once more with a solitary singular Thopter. He will pay for his insolence. We untap, we play a land, and go straight into the smash your fucking teeth in step. We cast Brave the Elements. A non-textless version will show you that we can choose a colour to give our creatures, all our white creatures that is, protection from said colour. All of his blockers are blue, which means that our opponent is at this stage in a state that we like to call absolutely, terribly, brutally murdered to death. He dies. Although Brea may be the format boogeyman that everyone's playing to give you the best access to 4 colour good stuff lists, everyone at some point in their magic career has to learn to respect the Hero of Bladehold. Fear her and her cyborg pony.
Oh, I just can't wait to be king.
In game 3, we find ourselves against our first on-camera partner commander in Timna the Weaver and Kram Ludwig's Opus. Having access to 2 commanders does seem very, very good in the sense that you always start the game with an extra card in hand because you have access to 2 commanders. I keep a hand of Inspector Gadget, Lion King, and then we draw the best mother in all of Magic.
Mother!
Tumbleguy starts to bring the pain and my mother is ousted, which is a bit of a crying shame. We go for the inevitable turn 2 Thalia whilst our opponent curves into Timna. Her card draw effect seems very good with our complete lack of a way to deal with this pesky 1-1 flyer at present time. However, Spirit of the Labyrinth will put a stop to all this horseshit with any luck. We untap and we slam Spirit and Mum into play. However, a snapcasted oust looks to put our Spirit away in our library, which is quite disappointing. We take another point of damage and our opponent draws another card, and I feel a little bit behind in board state and card advantage. If there was an advantage bar of sorts here in our games, we would be sliding down on the scale towards the end that says, my arsehole is shrinking from clenching too much, towards the size of a denomination of English currency equal to 5/100ths of an English pound. This is also known colloquially across the world as 5p territory. However, our prayers are answered when we draw a flash flyer that can be used to ambush that fucking Toppelgeist. We Wimbrisk and place a Spirit of the Lab under it, and the Lion King is deployed. Our opponent plays a Wasteland, which makes our heights feel pretty vulnerable and a little bit awkward. It tries as hard as not to make eye contact, hoping it won't notice. We get hit, he draws a card, then sticks a Lava Monster, and in spite of the best attempts to avoid each other at this party, the Wasteland takes Wimbrous Heights out, and we feel a little bit sad. On the upside, Lava Monster is currently offline and will not be online before the start of his next turn. We untap and play a land and smooth everything except Mummy. After blocks, we will surprise pump the team with our Flash Lord. However, we find out the hard way that the Celestial texture pumps all white creatures, including their ones, and thus we learn how to play with our own cards properly. His commander is now bigger and doesn't get wrecked like we thought it would. Toppelgeist continues to topple brutally into our face like a fucking pest, and he draws another card. We go full aggro, we play Mother of Clues and a pest that definitely isn't a chicken when you actually look at it close up enough. We slam into the red zone, keeping our flying mother back. Snappy goes in under the bus and we get through for a little bit. End step, he activates Love Monster and goes to kill Thalia, but I keep it alive with Mother of Runes. He then plays a Sword of Feast and Famine and equips it to the fucking flyer. We block, stopping the ensuing bullshit and meaning that he doesn't get to untap this turn at least. We slam Thalia's right hand woman and pump half the team and get to swing for the hills again. Force Spike Owlman looks to kill our signal pest whilst his commander goes under our lion shaped bus. I then cast a Mind Sensor whilst he is tapped out to play around another counterspell. Our opponent then casts and equips an Umazawa's Jitte to a flyer and I vomit a little bit in my mouth. You can pronounce it Jeet, you can pronounce it Jitte, but all I know is that it doesn't fucking matter. We're deep in the 5P territory now. How I beat this, I do not know. However, at least a pro white fly can indefinitely roadblock against the Jitte welding creature. I can't not attack here. I need to keep pressuring his life total as it's so low. So in we go. Where does it stop? Nobody knows. We keep back a blocker. Toppelgeist looks to eat our avoided up inspector whilst we use Mother Runes to avoid putting counters on Jitte for preventing the damage during the block. He goes to 7 and loses yet another creature. This is fine, I think. He then suits up that fucking one drop and plays a Relic Seeker and a Plowshares on our only blocker. Must be nice. We get hit, he untaps his lands, gets 2 counters on Jitte and basically lives the fucking dream. And we feel so sore from all of this clenching of our arse cheeks. Mother gets shot. Rest in peace, Mother. He then re-equips Jitte to the Relic Seeker and we vomit a bit more as we see that's going to be a quiet and awkward block. We draw Mentor of the Meek, which is actually pretty good here. It's a sweet combo of Brumaz as we get to make a token every turn and get to draw a card for the low cost of 1 mana. Sweet. We keep the pressure up by swinging into wildly. This is practically a flunge at this point. Attack with no maths where we just turn everything sideways. Seeker gets under the Lion King and the current counters are used to keep him alive in the face of the insurmountable cats. Our draw of the Mentor trigger is a Cataclysmic Gearhulk which will help us if we can't kill him, but we are looking like we are in good shape despite the nonsense on the show on the other side of the board. City of Brass pings him down to 1 in order to get into the red zone with a fully suited up Geist. 4 counters on Jitte allows him to kill a load of our shit, or at the very worst case, gain 8 life. My freed hunter ripped off the top gets stuck right back where it came from after my memory lapse, which isn't very nice. We flunge again and block from Grimmy, activation to kill Thalia, and all 4 counters from Jitte keep our opponent alive at 2 life. Toppelgeist gets in again and untaps his lands again and makes yet more fucking counters again. I hate Jitte when it isn't on my side of the board and I'm not the one playing with it. His commander comes down again, perhaps just to block, also to allow him to draw one more card. He plays a Thalia and a blocker and re-equips the Jitte to his commander. Our Fiend Hunter takes out the blocker, however, or would if he didn't simply concede to me casting it. GG, get wrecked. I lost the other 2 rounds to a series of awkward mulligans and some awkward punts from me. Overall, I really like this deck and I plan to jam it more in the league with some of the new toys coming from the Commander 27 Cats pre-con soon. Death and Taxes can never have enough cats, so sayeth the wise and mighty Cat Jesus. I hope you enjoyed the video this week. Perhaps this has inspired you to try some mono-coloured or even mono-white in 1v1 Commander. Let me know in the comment section below. Deck list for this week is in the description for you to be able to look at picking up cards over on mtgotraders.com. Don't forget to use the discount code of GGGETWRECKED for 8% off. Every time you do that, Cat Jesus does a little dance. Let me know how you get on or if you have a preferred colour to play in Solo Commander. And as always, if you like the video, please be sure to like it and give it a thumbs up. Comment to tell me what you thought and subscribe if you haven't already. Follow me over on Twitter, Instagram and Facebook, all of which I'm known as Pleasant Kenobi. If you really like the content and want to support the channel directly, then you can look to support me via my Patreon, which I will link to on the screen now. At the very least, if you enjoyed the videos and want to show some love, feel free to spread that love and share the video with your friends and show them how great Death and Taxes is in every format and how wonderful, witty and awesome I am. I will leave you with this thought-provoking quote on the matter of taxes. Will Rogers once said that income tax has made more liars out of Americans than golf has. I don't know the first thing about golf, but I do know that repacks seem to be the stand-in for budding young MTG YouTubers. Remember kids, stay safe, stay in school and don't fucking buy repacks.